Her Majesty, the Honorable Queen Carlotta of Mortville.
Welcome to Mortville, ladies. You are interrupting my flow of power. Every word I ever utter is to be taken as a direct royal proclamation or face death by the firing squad.
Yes, ma'am.
Ma'am, I'm your Royal Highness and I demand that you address me as such.
Yes, your Royal Highness.
Let's show them we're not kidding. Bring in the prisoner, Lieutenant Wilson.
Come on, you rats.
Any last words, goon face?
You can lick my raw hemorrhoids, you fat pig.
Oh, ready, aim, fire! I advise you to listen carefully, rubbish. Royal Proclamation number one. As long as you live in Mortville, you must always consider me your god.
Eggman! Eggman! Anybody home?
Cotton! Cotton! I'm in here! I hear the Eggman! In here! In here, Mr. Eggman! Eggs! Eggs! Oh, help! God! God! In here! In here! In here, Mr. Eggman! Here I am! Oh! Oh! Oh, the Eggman! The Eggman!
Oh! Lady, help my little princess to die!
Party for Babs on Thursday, and we'd like you to come as Edie's date.
Well, I would be honored to attend, and especially with such a beautiful date. And now, Edie, what will it be today? I have grade A extra large. I have grade A large. I have medium. I have small. I have brown, and I have white. Why, look, just look at these. So fresh you could hardly believe it. Why, they're just begging to be scrambled or fried or poached or hard-boiled or all around ready to be thrown into a big, fat, juicy omelet. How about it, Edie? What would it be for the lady that the eggs like the most?
I want them all.
Following program is brought to you in living color on...
Thank you. Thank you all from the bottom of my heart. Today, I'm thinking of a lot of things. I'm thinking of my old playground director in San Diego, California, Rodney Luscombe. My old high school coach, Wash Caldwell. My managers, who had such patience with me and helped me so much. Fellows like Frank Schellenbach, my first manager in San Diego in 1936. Domi Bush, who was my manager after the Red Sox, bought me and farmed me out to Minneapolis. Joe Cronin, who I can't say enough wonderful things about, and he knows, and I know how important he was to me. I'm thinking of Tom Yawkey, and I've always said it, and I'd like to repeat it again today, that to me, Tom Yawkey's the greatest owner in baseball. And I was lucky to have played on the club he owned, and I'm grateful here for his being here today. But I'd not be leveling if I've elected at that, because ball players are not born great. They're not born hitters or pitchers or managers, and luck isn't the key factor. No one has come up for a substitute for hard work. I've never met a great baseball player who didn't have to work harder at learning to play baseball than anything else he ever did. To me, it was the greatest fun I ever had, which probably explains why today I feel both humility and pride, because God let me play the game and to learn to be good at it. Proud because I've spent most of my life in the company of so many wonderful people. There are plaques dedicated to baseball men of all generations, and I'm privileged to join them. Baseball gives every American boy a chance to excel, not just to be as good as someone else, but to be better than someone else. This is the nature of man and the name of the game, and I've always been a very lucky guy to have worn a baseball uniform, to have struck out or to hit a tape measure home run. And I hope that someday, the names of Satchel Paige and Josh Gibson in some way can be added as a symbol of the great Negro players that are not here only because they were not given a chance. Now, I know Casey Stengel feels the same way, and I'm awfully glad to be with him on his big day. I also know I'll lose a dear friend if I don't stop talking, as I know I'm eating into his time. And that is unforgivable. So in closing, I'm grateful, and I know how lucky I was to have been born in America and had a chance to play the game I loved, the greatest game of them all, baseball.
Thank you very much, Commissioner Kuhn, league presidents, other distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I feel a great sense of humility, gratitude, and appreciation for this day and for what it means to me and my family. I'm extremely proud to be joining a group of men who performed on the baseball field, epitomize the highest and the best in professional athletics. I'm pleased to be joining them in the company of Travis Jackson, Happy Chandler, and Frank Robinson, some of baseball's greats. I also feel especially proud to be standing here where some years ago, Jackie Robinson and Roy Campanella proved the way and made it possible for Frank and me and for other blacks hopeful in baseball. They proved to the world that a man's ability is limited only by his lack of opportunity. The sheer majesty of this occasion and its significance overwhelms me. For truly, I reflect on my life, and particularly my 23 years in baseball. I am reminded of a statement I once read, and I quote, "The way to fame is like the way to heaven, through much tribulations." It had been for me to quote a very popular song, "A Long and Winding Road." Nevertheless, I have been extremely blessed in my lifetime. I stand here today because God gave me a healthy body, a sound mind, and talent. For 23 years, I took the talent that God gave me and developed it to the best of my ability. 23 years ago, I never dreamed that this high honor would come to me. For it was not fame I sought, but rather to be the best baseball player that I could possibly be.
Oh, hello. We're talking baseball before... Here we are talking baseball. Hey, we got Gonzo's here, and he's wearing a football shirt. And on the telephone is people that remember the baseball show, and Mr. Baseball is Peter Stilla. Peter, why don't you introduce yourself to the Ward 13 audience for those that, you know, like myself, who have no memory because of things outside of our control.
Yeah, this is Peter Stilla. I met Hopwood during our California days. And was a fairly regular guest on the baseball show with the our late friend Mr. Weeks, and yeah, glad to be back talking baseball again. Opening day is in 15 days, so
okay,
I'm ready.
What is the first game? Is it the Yankees and the Nationals?
Yeah. I think there's like actually on that first day, 23rd. Yeah, just two games. Yanks, Nats, and I think the other one is Giants, Dodgers, and then after that, the rest of the schedule starts with the rest of the team.
Well, let's you know, when I was doing some research on baseball, I saw that the ex-presidents tipped their hat to the Negro League, so I thought that'd be a good theme to start out with. That the Negro Leagues, which of course there were. Well, for people that don't know, Fleetwood Walker was in the major leagues, him and his brother. But it was Cap Anson, right, that refused to play him. him and there was another African-American player on the team, and that was the color bar. You know, after black people had been in the sport from the beginning, and, you know, and faced all sorts of indignities, they were finally banned from baseball. Was it Nate? I think it's 1887. So that's 60 years, and not till 1947 was baseball integrated. And, yeah, you and I were talking
about... Yeah, that's 60 years even, huh?
Yeah, 60... Well, no, it was 60 years, and that was 73 years ago. My uncles had actually seen Don Newcomb and Campy, the great Roy Campanella, three-time MVP, play in Nashua, which was B baseball. And it's amazing when you, in January 1947, before they integrated baseball, of the 13 owners in the National League, only Branch Rickey voted for it.
I got a question.
Yeah.
After Jackie Robinson made the debut, what was the period, what was the gap between the next one?
That was Larry Doby, right?
Larry Doby came up 6 weeks later in the American
League.
Okay. And he was an MVP.
It's actually a long time, though, 6 weeks to stand on a hill by yourself as Jackie.
Wow, they were. That's they hot, were.
That's 6 weeks is a long time.
They were alone. The sport was integrated very, very slowly.
From what I remember, Jackie Robinson wasn't, he was great, but he wasn't the cream of the crop, right? There were better than him that could have.
Well, there were players.
And he dominated when he came out.
They were very, what Branch Rickey needed the player, like he famously said, somebody that won't fight back. He had been an officer in the United States Army during World War II and had suffered discrimination.
That's tough.
And he was one of the few officers, until World War II, there were no black officers. And the Navy was supposed to have black officers and never went through with it. So
they picked him on character.
There was a black Babe Ruth. Josh Gibson was a great catcher.
Smashed the ball, right?
Oh, he was tremendous, but he was in his mid-30s, and he had problems with substance abuse, and that we find out much later from suffering from that. In fact, the play Fences is based on a character about him, and I think they made a movie a few years ago, and August Wilson's play Fences.
You talking about Fences with Denzel Washington?
Yeah, that was
originally. That was him?
Yeah, that's based on Josh Gibson, but
it is?
James Earl Jones originally played it on Broadway. So
I didn't know that. Because in the movie, they seemed well-known. He seemed well-known, but he didn't seem legendary.
Well, he was only to black players. But, of course, players like, hey, you know, Peter, I was reading about, we had just had Ted Williams in 1966, the greatest hitter of his time, and, you know, made the first plea that Negro League players be in the Major League Hall of Fame because they knew how great these players were, like Josh Gibson, Satchel Paige. He actually mentions Josh Gibson and Satchel Paige.
How'd that go over?
If you listen to it, nobody says anything.
Not it's very, not, yeah.
Crickets.
Yeah.
Crickets.
Right.
I think
good for him.
Didn't Williams actually face Satchel Paige in some sort of exhibition game or something?
Well, he faced him in 1948 because Satchel Paige, Bill Veeck brought him up, remember? They were in the 48 World Series, him and Larry Doby.
Oh, that's right. Well, I remember, you know, Doby came up. Of course, Satch was... Well, in 1948, I'm not sure how old he was.
Nobody knew how old he was. He played for
him. I also remember in 1965, Satchel Paige made his last major league appearance, and I think he was close to 60 years old at that point.
Yeah, Charlie O.
He pitched for an inning against the Red Sox in a game in 1965 for the Kansas City A's. And
Finley.
That's right.
He was the rookie of the year, wasn't he, at 48?
He was. No, wasn't Satchel Paige?
They thought he was 40. Nobody knew how old he was.
He was old, though, when he won rookie of the year, right?
Yeah, and he was considered you know, you can never tell. That's the great tragedy, because he never got to compete. But everybody said this is, because they barnstormed with each other, that this was the greatest pitcher many people had faced. The names that come up with him are like Bob Feller, who used to barnstorm with him, Rapid Robert.
He had a fastball.
And, oh, yeah. And Rick Sandy Koufax. But the guy was great. Woody Allen named his son, who now is, who turned against him fabulously. Ronan Farrow's real name is Satchel. He had to change it because Woody was a big baseball fan. They loved Satchel Paige because he's the a great character. Of great character. What's his famous saying, Peter? Don't look back.
Don't look behind you. Somebody might be gaining on you.
Yeah, don't look back. Somebody might be gaining on you.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Somebody.
He's almost 50 years old. He's a rookie in the World Series.
From what I saw, he was a really stubborn, resilient player. Like, didn't he go all nine in an All-Star game against, like, the exhibition game? They used to have exhibition games.
Oh, yeah.
Didn't he just, like, take down, like, all the best of the major leagues in one game?
Oh, yeah. There were all the stories about that.
He was,
that.
Like, 94 years old.
No. They're talking about he came up in the 20s, and he was the great star of the Negro Leagues.
What made him great? Was it location?
Velocity? His control.
His control, right?
They said he had tremendous control.
So he could just hit a spot.
Oh, yeah. He could put the ball anywhere.
And he could
Roger Clemens. Young Roger Clemens had the control and the speed.
Probably mess with someone's head, too, I assume.
Oh, yeah. Because,
chained up,
you know,
at the right spot, yeah.
Yeah. There were all sorts of legends about it.
That's what Koufax did, right? Control, right? He wasn't like a speedballer, right?
Oh, he had a tremendous fastball.
Well, he had
a curve.
Velocity.
He did.
And control.
You know, and I think Paige did, too.
Yeah.
Yeah, you're right. And Paige had a lot of stuff, right? I mean,
he had many pitches.
He had, like, you know, all sorts of breaking pitches, too. And then he, you know, mix in a plus-plus fastball.
Right.
But most of it was a few people saw it, you know. It's kind of sad, but... Yeah,
but all the baseball players knew the quality of these people because they played against them. They barnstormed with them.
People compared them to Pedro Martinez in his prime,
which is that, you know.
So like that Pedro could hit. Pedro get you at 94 when he musters down, and that'll surprise you. But he wasn't that. 94 is still fast. But I'm sure it's well placed.
But the major, what's the difference between a major league player? Of course, you got to hit a fastball, and you've seen how, like Peter, we used to go to the batting cage. He could hit stuff much faster than I could, and but it's hitting breaking balls. Well, if you can't, a lot of great minor league players can't handle a major league.
Pedro's golden goose was his changeup,
and Pete Rose said, "Well, you." Pete Rose said about Sandy Koufax, he had a curveball that would come at you. You think it's a fastball, and then it would break. He'd just fall off, like falling off the table. But these guys were great, but they never had a chance. The thing is, you know, people like Jackie Robinson, Larry Doby, they were all in World War II. They served. And yet you had a one-armed outfielder. Didn't he play for Cleveland, Pete Gray? A one-armed
out.
Rather than let Josh Gibson come out.
Yeah.
Let Josh Gibson come out.
They want to avoid putting black players in because they used a guy with one arm.
Brendan, can we go to a three ways? All of us, yeah.
Was he any good?
No, he hit like 240.
Oh, Pete Gray?
He hit 240.
Did he hit a home run once? No.
Jesus. So the minor leagues, these were career minor league players they brought up because the people, you know, the major leaguers got drafted or joined. And, you know, Ted Williams, Joe DiMaggio,
take the one-arm
players.
Guy.
We'll take, instead of a great black player.
Yeah.
Because Kennesaw Mountain Landis, the commissioner, was an out-and-out racist from Georgia.
Well, yeah.
Speaking of Georgia...
His name is coming off the, what is it, the MVP trophy?
Yeah, it's about time. Really?
That's the latest thing. Yeah, they want Landis gone.
Well,
which makes sense, you know?
I mean, the guy was a vicious bigot. you know, he stopped integration. You know, there was, they say the Bill Veeck story about Bill Veeck wanted to buy a team and then stock it with Negro League players. That is a confabulation and just a good yarn, and he loved to tell good yarns. But because the sheer fact was, as long as he was alive, it could never happen, you know?
A good yarn? Is that like a fishtail?
Oh, yeah. That baseball, you know. They didn't have statistics until 1969, the baseball encyclopedia.
That's why you really never know how old Sachem Paige was.
No, nobody really does. I guess they do now. But it's a trap.
Yeah, I think somebody has tried to, like, compile statistics from the Negro Leagues, but it's an exercise in frustration. But, you know, I think that there is out there somewhere, like, something resembling a Negro Leagues, baseball encyclopedia. But whether the data is very trustworthy is another thing altogether. You know?
Right, because it has to be taken out of newspapers.
So
which,
I got a question for you guys.
Published for the what was called at the time Negro or Colored Press.
What were the noticeable, like, glaring differences between the Negro Leagues and the major leagues at the time?
Speed.
Speed and power?
Not power, speed.
And ferocity, like?
The type of play that the National League excelled at, because it had more African Americans.
But
well
speed
into,
for sure.
Well into the 90s, that type of National League play, where it's like almost a chess game, rather than which Casey Stengel created. You get two men on and some stud just hits a three-run homer, which became the American League style play, the Yankees type of play.
Well, that's the game.
Yeah. You never give a way out. That's Earl Weaver's thing. It's the National League, and even before the designated hitter, the National League was known more for, moving guys over, playing a couple of runs here, a couple of runs there. Whereas the American League was always the big inning league, with the philosophy was that in most games, like 80% of games, the winning team scores more runs in one inning than the losing team scores in nine. So it was just a different philosophy, but our National League was utilized a lot of that speed much more than the American League did.
Right.
That's gone now, you know.
Right
that?
Up until the PEDs, steroids thing.
They got rid of the DH.
We were talking about
Ty. They got rid of the pitcher hitting this year to limit.
Yeah. Ty Cobb.
Yeah, they did.
Oh, we'll talk about that in the second half hour. We want to go to that.
Oh, sorry.
Ty Cobb, stole bases. He hit. He could hit for power, but he didn't. And he ran.
Too.
Oh, yeah. And he ran. But Babe Ruth said, he always said he was influenced by Shoeless Joe Jackson, had his swing. He added an uppercut to it, and the power he had, that revolutionized baseball, and he became the greatest player history, ever.
The uppercut, you mean?
Yeah, and the power he had was tremendous. And it was soon imitated by other players, although not all of them before Peds could do it as long as he did it. But Jimmy Fox, Chuck Klein hit 370 with 40. Once you added the uppercut, but that became like an American League type of. And the Yankees, that's what they had, that power.
Had a heavy bat, too, right, Babe?
Oh, yeah.
Like a 50?
No, I think it was 40.
Yeah, it was,
above 40.
It was, crazy, how big these bats were,
Have you ever felt a bat like that?
I barely pick them up, and it's funny, because the power guys today, they hit these bats like that.
Whip.
Tony Gwynn used to use,
Yeah.
But a different era.
But, in the old, before the lively ball, every team in the major leagues, which were all white up until the 20s, what I'm saying, that's Babe Ruth, up until 1947, you had to scrap for runs. You had to manufacture them. And so in my lifetime, up until PEDs, like Peter and I both lived in the San Francisco Bay Area, you could have both brands of baseball, the National League baseball with all the speed and the daring and more strategy, like a chess game,
Then
the, get the two guys on and get a stud.
That was like the 80s. They did that cookie cutter stadium thing.
Yeah.
But back in the day, they had 450-foot fences.
Oh, jeez.
Crazy. Like, Polo Grounds was, like, so
500
long.
Yeah, some odd feet to dead. And Babe Ruth would hit home runs.
He'd still knock them out.
Yeah.
And the National League stadiums, too, like, from the 60s to the 90s, they had
all
a
cookie
lot
cutter.
More AstroTurf than the American League stadiums did. The American League was mostly natural grass for, you know, most of its, you know, history, you know, in that era.
That's true.
And the National League, there was a lot of it. There was a majority, I think, AstroTurf stadiums. And that affected the, you know, type of play. And
You just hit the ball down. I mean, that
Cincinnati,
Charlie
Lott. Atlanta.
Right. That
they
was
all did, Houston, they all did that.
They're all based on Busch Stadium, which I think opened in 64 for the Cardinals. The classic confrontation between the two styles of baseball is the 64 World Series, where the last of the great Yankees dynasty, the one with Mickey Mantle and Maris and Whitey Ford and Yogi Berra, got beat by an exciting Cardinals team that was, you know, integrated. They had many black players where there was... In 1964, I think they of course they had Elston Howard, who was an MVP in 63, first Yankee, black Yankee, and they had one or two others. I see their faces and the names, but you know I'm an old fart.
In the movie Bronx Tale, that was a part of that movie.
Elston Howard was the first black Yankee.
Yeah, in 55, because you know you have to Tom Yawkey. And they took away Yawkey Way, Jersey City, because of his racism. Tom Yawkey had a minor league team in Birmingham, and Willie Mays is from Birmingham and was on the Negro League team. So he had the rights to Willie Mays. They never signed him. The scout would call Boston, and nope, nobody wanted to hear about him. But the Yankees turned him down, too. The idea of Willie Mays playing at Fenway Park with Ted Williams, he hit 660 home runs. He did 2 years in the service, Willie Mays. He would have been, you know, broken Babe's record, you know, if he didn't get something bad happened. Because with Red Sox in that time, bad things
gap?
Would happen.
What was the gap? You think he would have had 100 home runs in 2 years?
No, he hit 660, so 55 would have done it. He came up, I think he did it the Korean War, 52-53.
That's what Ted did too, right?
Ted was lost 5 years. Korea and World War II.
49, was it?
Ted was the man.
Ted came up in 39. He was in the service 43, 44, 45, and then in Korea, both
his
the 51, 52, 53.
Out of control.
What?
Imagine being a fighter pilot and a hitter. His hand-eye coordination.
Oh, it's tremendous.
Then he went on to be a world-class fly fisherman.
Oh, yeah. Like, so you know your baseball.
I know my baseball. And then, yeah, his hand-eye coordination, like... He could just do it. He could do it.
When they made him an instructor during World War II, they said he had the best eye-hand coordination they'd ever seen.
But to be a fighter pilot, you got to be pretty decent, right?
When I was young, I had 15-20, which is better than 20-20. Ted had 10-20.
I wonder if his service had something to do or influenced his stance on getting the Negro League into the round.
Could have, yeah.
Being, you know, intertwined with, you know, everybody. You know?
Yeah. Commissioner Kennesaw Mountain Landis, who's named after Kennesaw Mountain, Georgian, a great rebel. He died in 44, and Happy Chandler, the governor and a Democratic hack politician, was made the commissioner. And he said, these men served in World War II. He would not oppose integration, and he allowed it. Because the teams didn't want it.
A lot of pride in America back then, huh? To go play baseball and then bounce out in the middle of your career and be a fighter pilot and then come back like.
Well, when we were Joe DiMaggio
was he drafted?
No, I think
or he went on
joined.
His own merit.
He joined. But when we were kids, Peter and I was born in '59. Peter was born around then. We would see players like I remember Carlton Fisk came to West High School. He was in his military uniform because you could get drafted and you do eight. You know, you do 2 years.
Yeah, didn't he play at Hooksett or North Little League or something?
Carlton Fisk played basketball at UNH.
Yeah, supposedly Balboni hit one off the JFK.
How did he go to UNH?
Yeah, Pudge went to UNH, and he was an outstanding basketball player. He and Sandy Koufax had that in common. Koufax was a great basketball player at the University of Cincinnati.
Now, was Fisk that good? Like,
oh, yeah.
I picture him as like Jake Taylor from Major League. You know, that broken down knees guy.
Oh, no.
But he was good.
He was a brilliant quarterback.
He was great.
Brilliant quarterback. He could handle pitching stuff.
Now,
do you think
Do you think Veritek was a better like captain or Fisk blew him out of the water?
We're talking about.
No, I mean Veritek was an excellent player, but I think Fisk all around just did more. You know,
he's a Hall of Famer.
Veritek was my era.
At least as good as defensive catcher.
I hold him on a pedestal.
But yeah, Veritek did have some great leadership qualities. Yeah. You know?
The greatest catcher of that time was Johnny Bench, who could hit and catch, a great catcher. But the great rivalry was Fisk and Thurman Munson, who won the MVP.
Yankees, right?
Yeah.
Munson, yeah.
And catchers, though, wore down so quickly in those days.
Can you imagine?
Johnny Bench regularly played 160, caught 160 games, where Casey Stengel would never... You know, about 125 games he'd put Yogi in, and they'd put him 25 or 30 games in left field. Because it just wears you out.
Yeah, it wasn't until the 80s even where, you know, teams would regularly use like two catchers, and
the
second string catcher would play more than 40 games, or at least 40 games. But, it was just like, there was like, they use catchers like they use flipping shortstops, you know. You're expected to play 160, you know.
You're our catcher this year, so.
Well, the gerbil he kept putting Carlton Fisk out there and wore him out in 78.
The gerbil?
Tell them who the gerbil is.
I thought we were talking about baseball today.
Oh, do you have anything to say about Eddie Casco, who recently died, the manager of the Red Sox, who blew at least two pennants I can think of?
I communicated that with you as my dad during the day. My dad was like the ultimate Red Sox fan.
Was that the goal?
Like, right after they had Dick Williams, who was, you know, probably among the greatest managers that they've ever had, you know, they brought in this completely hapless Eddie Casco, who, you know, put a manager, Dairy Queen, as they say.
The
Sox had some really good teams in the early 70s, and, you know, Casco would always find a way to blow it, like, late in the year.
74. Yeah.
Do you guys blame Jimmy Williams for not taking Pedro out?
Let's not talk about that. I was with Vika when that happened.
John, you get so worked up.
She's wondering why I'm going crazy.
It's just a baseball game, John.
Little did she know, the next 17 years, you know.
Yeah.
Be
canned for that. I mean, Grady Little took over. And
it was Grady Little that got canned.
No, it was Grady that did it, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
Right.
Sorry. Jimmy Williams was never even got into the playoffs or something.
Jimmy would bench Pedro for being 5 minutes late. Jimmy, very stubborn, he'd say.
He was part of Bobby Cox's,
I can see that.
Crew.
Cut from the same cloth, for sure.
But, it's apparent now that the reason the Red Sox from 1918 to 2004 didn't win a World Series wasn't the curse of Bambino. It was the curse of racism. When you don't pick somebody up like Willie Mays, one of the all-time, the greatest living player, you trade away Cecil Cooper because he had an integrated marriage, otherwise a white wife. And Ben Ogilvie, too. But it was just crazy. Do you know that Jim Rice, when he was arguably the best hitter in the American League, and what was
Rookie of the Year and MVP the same year, right?
We're talking about 82, 83. There were no other blacks on the team.
Desktop. Living
it's
in Boston.
Crazy.
And he's outspoken about the way Boston was in the 80s, too. And you know what? Go ahead. Talk about it, because it's probably true. Can you show videos of these people? They got their windbreakers on and their mustaches, and they're just... They got their Miller Lite in one hand. I imagine winning Rookie of the Year and MVP, right?
No, that was Fred Lynn, but Jim Rice...
Jim Rice, in 1978, had one of the all-time greatest
ever.
Seasons ever.
Yeah.
Now, didn't he win MVP, but not Rookie of the Year?
No.
Which is a weird thing.
The Gold Dust twins were Freddie Lynn, who was born in 51, and Jim Rice, who was born in 53, so he's only 22. They came up in 75. They both hit over 300. They both had 20-plus home runs, and they both had 100 RBI. But Jim Rice broke his arm at the end of the season, so he wasn't in the World Series.
In the playoff. But the all-time great excuse for the Sox that, you know, they didn't win that World Series was, geez, it would have been nice to have, like, somebody like Jim Rice in the lineup, you know?
That happens all the time.
He was a great player, and, you know, I think he deserved
great
the awards he got, but, you know, Rice was right there with them, too.
But for Freddie, he would have won the Rookie of the Year, but Freddie hit .331. And was flawless in outfield. He was one of the best fielding outfielders since Joe DiMaggio.
Kind of like a Pedroia who had his flash. He won Rookie of the Year and then MVP the next year. But then he fell off. Didn't Lynn kind of have his, like, four-year stint?
Pedroia was a better team player.
Oh, yeah.
Freddie was kind of out there.
Freddie Lynn had a lot of, like, you know, California flake on him, you know. But... He was a great player. And his numbers at the end of his career were nowhere near I thought they were going to be when he first started. I thought he was going to be like a flipping 500 home run guy. Really, he
looked
like he was going to be an all-time great player.
Like a
years, wouldn't you say, Hop?
Yeah.
Yeah, if you take... Fred Lynn up to you take his first half of the career and you graft it onto Dwight Evanson's half of the career and you have a first ballot Hall of Famer. But but now that Chet Lemon has changed everything for the Hall of Fame, right, Peter?
Do you remember Ellis Burks and Benzinger?
Oh yeah.
Those two rookies coming up together. Yeah. It's probably similar to the
racing. Lyman was probably a better player.
Oh, yeah. Excuse me. It was Harold Baines. Chet Lemon was a better player.
Chet Lemon.
I remember it's like, why isn't Chet in but for him? But one of the ways to get into the Hall of Fame is have a lot of friends on the Veterans Committee, which is what happened with Harold Baines.
Or there were milestones at the time, benchmarks, where as long as you got that 3,000 hit,
yeah,
you were
in. That's crazy. You know, Tommy John was a better pitcher than Don Sutton. Don Sutton never won 20. You can go back to the 1960s and you read about him. Is he going to win 20? He's going to win 20. Is he going to win 20? But he just hung on, and he won 320-some
bucks. Yeah, he was one of the longevity guys.
But she's not
right.
Tommy John.
You know, he was never one of the top half dozen pitchers in any one of his careers, you know.
He was a quality number three.
That's 300 wins, though.
Yeah, but Tommy John won 288. Jim Koch should be in the Hall of Fame, 285. He had to play with Minnesota.
Is Tommy John not in the Hall of Fame?
No.
What?
No.
That's baloney.
Yeah,
that's a whole other show.
It took like a few ballots for like Burt Blyleck to get in the Hall of Fame, and he should have been like, you know, maybe not a first ballot guy, but his strikeout numbers, his shutouts, it was ridiculous. And it's all because he didn't quite have 300 wins, you know, and it's these magic numbers are kind of ridiculous. But, you know, that's what happened.
Remember Chris Berman's nickname for him? Burt Be Home by 11.
So many other things.
Well, why don't we got another, 15 minutes. Why don't we talk, Peter, why don't we talk about baseball in the COVID era? What do you guys think is going to happen? Do you think baseball is going to be able to pull this off?
I don't know.
It's anybody's guess.
They won't finish the season.
I'm hoping. One thing that's really looking like it's going to work against it is, you know, 30 different stadiums they're playing in and across the nation. And that has got to be a concern because, you know, you look at what the NHL and the NBA are doing, and, you know, that their seasons were almost over anyway, so I guess that enters into it. But, maybe baseball would have been better served by, you know, picking out a couple of markets and having the American League teams playing that and the National League teams playing the other one. I don't know. I'm hopeful, but I'm not too sure either.
I got a dark horse answer. The reason this will not happen is because pitchers aren't allowed to spit or go to their mouth. Name a pitcher that doesn't lick their fingers every single pitch. They were in Walker Buehler from the Los Angeles Dodgers did an interview, and I watched him on this guy Theo Von. I watched, and he was like, "I don't know what I'm gonna do. They say I can't go to the mouth, and they'll fine you." But he's like, "I'm still gonna do it because you go your whole life. Your instinct." Baseball players spit.
Maybe they could put a collar like you put on a dog.
What are you? You're not allowed to turn two? Too many people touching the ball? You know what I mean? Like, what are they going to do? Incinerate the balls afterwards?
Baseball games, if it weren't for like spitting and like ass whacking.
Yeah, grabbing your nuts. Can you grab your nuts?
I don't know. Hey, now talk about basketball. They're playing in like what you call a bubble.
Yeah, they've got it set up. It's in Florida, Orlando, at Walt Disney Universe or whatever it is. And, so...
Because you only need courts.
Orlando, Florida, and that's... So we'll see. You know, I mean, they have issues, too.
The NHL is...
People are going to lie about having their COVID, too.
Toronto and Edmonton. So... At least they were smart to get out of the U.S., they're getting as far away as they can possibly can, so, they'll probably pull it off, too.
Someone's going to sneeze on the court and be like, it's an allergies, I swear, and everyone's going to be like, I don't know about this anymore, because people are going to lie, because you get game checks, correct?
But they just...
You get paid per game, though, correct? Is that true?
Is that it, Peter? I don't know, but it depends on their contract.
I don't know. They're going to get tested. I don't know if it's... Every day or once every, there's a protocol where, the players and everyone, the umpires, they're going to be tested every Lord knows what.
They could be cheating. They're going to have fake boogers like they do in the steroids.
They send you home for like at least 2 weeks, 3 weeks.
Hey, man, can I get your boogers, dude? It's their livelihood. They're going to have like... fake boogers installed in their nose to pass the COVID test. That's what they do for steroid tests. They do an oil change, they call it.
Well, actually, in the steroid test, they were warned 3 weeks ahead of time they were going to get them.
Can you blow your nose in this tissue for me, man?
Well, they just had a thing with the lab. One of the labs or the
You're talking
lab.
Hundreds of thousands of dollars, though.
The baseball was using, It can't process them fast enough.
How can you have a 40-man roster and
60-man?
They're making the pitchers sit in the stands. Did you know that? That's a fact.
What are they going to deal? Are they going to sell the hot dogs?
Like Walker Buehler was saying.
They're going to give them pom-poms and have them lead cheers.
They might have fights out there that might be very dangerous.
They're actually, the starters aren't required to be there. Like
Kershaw, that never made sense that they
Clayton
are
Kershaw
there.
Said he's going to watch 80% of the games from his pool. Literally said that.
Quite odd. I don't see why they're there anyway. But
He makes $80,000 a pitch.
Here's the thing. Some guys are opting out. Even Trout's thinking of opting out. But you have to be designated that you are an at-risk person in order to keep your pro rata share of your contract this year.
Or if you're up for negotiation next year. Or like Walker Buehler, again, I hate to keep referencing him. They call it a platform year. He's in his last year of a rookie deal. He can't sit out. He has to play.
Right.
What
good is it,
It's such a weird... What are you going to do? The arbitration is going to go, he did good, but he couldn't sustain it a whole year. Or, if you do poorly, you did poorly. It's a lose-lose situation.
Yeah.
But what are you going to do? You have to play.
I mean, look at Mookie. He's, kind of in that situation. Too.
Yeah.
I don't think that if he hits, 240 over 60 games, he's going to get, penalized too much. But, hey, it's...
But what?
You know, the revenues are like, they're not going to be there either, you know. There's only so much that can be spent on whoever's going to be a free agent this winter.
That was good for 10 beers a game minimum. That's 80 bucks.
It's a good situation to be going into your walk here, that's for sure.
But what is all this time off and not really playing and then playing this extended spring training in a way, how is that going to affect players? Because this is, like, as everybody says, and it's never contradicted, this sport of, you know, not of inches but of millimeters, and it's a skill sport that supposedly has more skill than any other. And you've seen people that have had, you know, injuries or something that have been off for a year. Sometimes they just don't come back.
I think people are getting used to the world without sports. It's like when it's like when your girlfriend breaks up with you and you're heartbroken, and then after 6-7 weeks you're like over it. It's like, I could live without sports now because I am.
You're not watching Korean baseball?
I'm living without it right now, and I'm trying.
I'm going to gorge on lacrosse next week.
Do you know what this is doing to the media?
I'm just like, it's... I haven't gotten used to it, we'll put it that way.
Dude, if you watch the hot dog competition, you can hear every sound.
Well, we'll get easy G in that.
I did draw the line at the hot dog competition. I just, like, you know, I just felt myself getting, like, you know, colon malignancy is the only time I ever watched that. So, I'm ready for anything. The sooner the better.
You know, it's strange because baseball got the country through World War II, even with third-rate major league players and one-armed outfielders.
And Abbott did it.
Here you have this, like, you know, pandemic, mass malaise. It seems like baseball could have done a much better job of organizing that. And I know, you know, they have batteries of lawyers, there's all sorts of contracts, television, then there's the insurance companies, there's reinsurance companies. I mean, we're talking about billions and billions of dollars in revenue. But
I think the owners are going to take a hit.
This
isn't
even a half-assed... Their attempt to give us a season wasn't even
But by playing
that.
The season, the owners get to keep the price tag on their franchise. You know what I mean? That's why they're taking a hit.
Yeah.
You know what Trevor Bauer said?
Because that's always
silly. Like, we took a situation that was incredibly horrible and somehow managed to make it 10 times worse.
I can't... It's... You know, I know what's going on, but... Oh, jeez, you know?
You think anyone's going to wear a mask in the game? Ooh.
Can they?
I don't know.
What's that?
That would help. That wouldn't be. I couldn't.
Talk about a statement.
How could you play a sport with a mask on?
I don't know.
Here, let's try to do the show with masks.
All right, I'll hit some fungos to you.
I mean, you know, how can you wear a mask in that type of weather?
I mean, catchers do
it's
it.
Summer. Yeah, but they're not wearing one of these. Is this the right way?
Brilliant. My God. This guy... You're one of those guys that wears it on your chin just to not get shamed in public, aren't you?
No, just to hide my chin, my double, triple chin.
You should wear a catcher's mask everywhere.
Do you think it's worthwhile at all to, like, try to make any sort of predictions about this thing? Or is it just, beyond the scope of logical analysis?
Everybody will die.
Jesus.
Yeah. That's my...
You heard it here, everybody.
Prediction, the champion will be...
pain! I predict pain.
But,
somehow I think
that... It's probably not even worth making any predictions. I mean, who knows?
I have one.
Royals?
Somehow, of all the sports, baseball will screw it up.
I got Colonel Mustard in the library with the wrench.
I have Colonel Mustard, on a squeeze play.
Yeah.
You might as well just go there.
Who is the best, I don't know, because it's a sprint, right? Then you've got the regular playoffs. Well,
Yankees, Astros, and Red
Yankees Sox
are
considered
the
favorite right now.
They always are. Red Sox are always there.
What about the Dodgers?
Everyone's saying Yankees, Dodgers. The Rays are getting a lot of love. But who the hell knows?
Well, with all the cheating now, you never know. There could be...
We could bring back Eddie Casco.
There could be, fake people infecting people under the table, like stealing signs and infecting people, like throwing their snot rock, like...
That'll be the next scandal.
Putting boogers in the rosin bag.
Like, being infected air into the opposing team's locker rooms.
You can only touch the rosin bag four times.
Hey, I don't know why they just don't go to CGI and just create a system.
Yeah,
because 40% of all Americans believe Donald Trump. You know, sports people are probably, you know, even more gullible in some ways in their favorite sport. So, you know, you just CGI the whole season. I don't know why, you know, one Disney team, didn't step in.
One team that won't be affected is Tampa
just
Bay.
Like they did the moon landing.
They had 400
Stanley
people
Kubrick,
a game.
Kubrick, where are you when we need you?
Tampa Bay will have more fans this year than they did last year.
Even with, but they're only allowed to have a certain amount of people in the stadium,
they
right?
Still, they social
can they sit next to each
years,
other?
Man. They've been doing that. The Marlins have been social distancing for 5 years now.
My sister always said she liked the Tampa Bay. She used to go down there for business.
Did you know, you
could get a cheap ticket and a great seat because there's nobody
you
in there.
You can pay $100 and have a cardboard cutout of you put in the stands. That is a fact.
Oh, come on.
In L.A.
The Marlins are going to have cardboard cutouts of Pamela Anderson in every seat.
See, I want to get one of Hopwood in a non-flattering picture.
Jesus.
Back in his San Francisco
just
days.
Just go through the shows and you can find, you just screenshot.
What was he like in the San Francisco days? That's what I want to know.
We actually We didn't live in San Francisco. We lived in where did we work? Foster City. Yeah. We lived next
to Foster City.
We worked.
Yeah, I can see who the Giants put their cardboard cutouts on, like the Village People. Mm.
I want to put Ruby Keeler's cardboard cutouts. Didn't we watch that show, you know, with her head bouncing up and down on a spring? Or was that my college days? It all bleeds into each other.
Footlight Parade.
Oh, that's her, yeah, that Jimmy Cagney. We go at the Stanford Theater.
This is how I feel about you.
That if you find love, an optical illusion too. Are the stars out tonight? I don't know if it's cloudy or bright, 'cause I only have eyes for you. The moon may be high, but I can't see a thing in the sky, 'cause I only have eyes for you. I don't know if we're in the garden or on a crowded avenue. You are here, so am I. Maybe millions of people go by, but they all disappear from view. And I only have eyes for you.
Gee, Jimmy, that's swell.
Bay Area was great back then. Nowadays,
who would your cutout be if you had to get one cutout?
You mean? If
you could pick one person to be in Fenway for the whole season. You get a
Oh,
seat.
I was thinking of being with me, like on the
you'd
show.
You put yourself on?
I guess
on?
It'd be a young Julie Christie.
A Julie Christie, okay. I do Elf.
Well, yeah, that's, you know, the Hopwood's right on. It's just like my personal feeling is in the history of cinema, if you had to pick one movie that had the most beautiful woman in it at all time, I'm going to say Julie Christie and Petulia.
Their eyes brave and courageous, higher and higher, until eventually, after a long, arduous journey, they arrive at the summit of Penguindon. And here comes Elgin first, and behind him it looks like George. Behind him is Ringo, and behind him is Robert. Elgin's going to do his famous three-quarter turn to the left dive. Okay, come on down, Elgin.
That hurt.
Yeah, this is Elgin. He's coming out to play the Humboldt Concerto today. His beak is insured with Lloyd's of London for $50,000, so we have to be very careful with him. Who are we going to have dive first? It looks like George, believe it or not. George in his 45th dive today. Getting set. George is going to do his beautiful jackknife dive that he won at the Cannes Olympics. a second prize. I gave him the dive. All the surfboard riders, just the agile, flexible, courageous, brave penguins. We've got four. We're going for five. Okay, turn it around. Wait a minute. We got a fifth. I think. Yes, all right. And send it out to sea. And the cry goes out. Leopard shark, leopard shark. Start talking about your divorce, about your brother-in-law, and how things were in Las Vegas. Here we go.
Oh, geez.
It's always a young Jewish.
Cardboard cut out to her in every season.
Not
well,
a 70-year-old. Yeah, not a Twilight.
What is the baseball Julie Christie connection? I will give a 2020 Trump bill.
She was banging Lou Gehrig.
Lou Gehrig?
Died
the year she was born.
I don't know who she is.
She shares a base. I'll give you a clue. She shares a birthday with the greatest player not in the Hall of Fame.
Oh, don't just give it away. Oh, Pete Rose's birthday?
She shares a birthday with the greatest player not in the Hall of Fame?
Yeah. He already got the it. I guess they threw that.
You're talking about Tommy John, right?
We're talking Pete Rose. Both born on April 14th. 1941, so she'll be 80. So yeah, I'm thinking more of the Julie Christie around
so
24
young,
years old.
Young Pete Rose.
Hey, I had Julie on one of my intros. I'll have to send it to you. The one with the guy pooping and the guy
she
pooping.
She was flipping unbelievably gorgeous.
I gotta see it. Can you pull a picture up?
What does this have to do with baseball?
If anyone in our viewing audience has never seen the movie Petulia, by all means, give it a look.
Are you coming on next week?
She was hot.
We can talk of Petulia.
I'll let John tell you,
Put it Richard
this
Lester.
Put it this way, John can't stand up right now.
He can probably come on next week.
Well, I didn't know Gonzo was a real baseball nut. That's great.
Oh, big time.
Yeah, yeah.
I played for Central, post 79. I did the whole thing.
Oh, I love baseball. I know we're going to get, everybody that's B-I-T-C-H-ing about it now is going to get into it.
No Legion baseball anymore. That sucks.
Well, I'll tell you, man.
Should have been 81
games. I didn't think that I would give a...
Rats behind.
Rats behind, about, as soon as they announced it, it's just like, all right, I'm on board,
It's always that way. We're Red Sox fans that go back to 1967.
I'll tell you who's happy is DraftKings. They're like, damn.
We'll do that next week.
They're probably responsible for this all happening right now. Like, sneaking a season in. Even 10 games will help out.
But you understand
it's
that.
$1 billion.
Next week, there'll be a bit. When does it start, Peter? When does the season start?
The 23rd.
Oh. See, that's right. Allegedly. They haven't been doing anything.
It's still a couple of weeks.
Until 30% of the league gets COVID.
It could happen. It could. What was the movie with John Waters?
And people are
going
to get.
Lady. And what was the egg lady? What did she say, Peter?
If they were chickens, there wouldn't be any eggs.
And what was the name of Divine's character? Babs? Babs. And Babs tells her, oh, mother, there'll always be chickens. And what does she say to that?
Babs, where do eggs come from?
From little chickens, Mama. They lay them and we eat them.
But suppose someday there weren't any chickens. Would that mean there wouldn't be any eggs?
Oh, I don't think you have to worry about that, Mama.
But is it true, Babs? If there weren't any chickens, there wouldn't be any eggs. Is that true?
I suppose so, Mama, but there will always be chickens. You can be sure of that.
But suppose someday it happens. Suppose someday there weren't any chickens. Oh, Babs, what could I possibly do? And then the Eggman wouldn't have a job? It might happen, Babs. What could I do?
Now, Mama, that's just egg paranoia. I think you're being very silly. There will always be chickens. Why, there are so many chickens now that we can eat some and let some of them live in order to supply us with eggs. Chickens are plentiful, Mama. The world will never be without chickens. You can be sure of that.
Okay, what did you say before this? Because we want to get the... this.
I want
to
see Julie Christie.
That's not what you said. And Brendan's talking on the phone, so we can't rewind.
Was she more of like a bottom or like an upper? Like what was her?
You don't even know Julie Christie.
Or just a beautiful
is?
Face.
Remarkable face.
Or just
she was Lara and Dr. Zhivago.
Sex appeal, cute.
You know, just just from toe to top to toe. It was just a thing of.
We won't tell him about Don't Look Now.
Oh my God. Was she hotter than Jennifer Love Hewitt?
Jennifer Love Hewitt's a TV star.
Julie Christie. All right, Google Julie Christie.
Okay, we got a couple more minutes. Anything to say about about the baseball?
Wear your mask. You're killing grandma.
No, Peter's a liberal. Peter's father's the one who coined the term the impossible dream for the 67 really? Red Sox.
What?
Yeah, he was at the Globe.
Yes.
That's cool.
Yeah, he was at the Globe. Yeah, that's my dad's
67, right?
Yeah. Appointment with the legend there.
Although it wasn't possible because it didn't.
So suffice it to say, I grew up in a baseball
that's cool.
environment.
Well, it's Jocelyn's father had his thing with fame was being on the stage at the Hungry Eye with Fan Fox and Wilbur Mills. But that's another story.
Hungry Eye? You're talking about the
script club. The third most powerful man in the world.
There's some baseball in there somewhere.
I saw David Ortiz drop $5,000 at Platinum Plus in Portland, Maine. That's
on what?
Strippers.
That we're not going down there. David Ortiz is going to be. Well, Edgar Martinez is in the Hall of Fame now, right?
Well, he had 3,000 hits.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'd rather have seen Ortiz be the first.
Ortiz was nasty.
He was great.
So good.
Oh, I love David.
Yeah,
Ortiz.
He's gotta be. Come on.
Kelly Ayotte's favorite Red Sox player. Okay, we're going to sign off. We got to sign off, Peter, because we got to scrub this
real
place
quick,
down.
Do you think Griffey should have got all the votes like he did?
We'll talk about that next week. We'll be here next week.
That's called a tease. That's called a tease.
You've been invited to be on the radio show.
Yeah, I'm going on Connerton. I'm going to mix it up.
Right.
Pauly C in the house. Just kidding.
Jesus.
You just stay away from me. You just stay away from me.
Bye, folks. We'll see you next week. We'll do another
baseball show. Wear your mask. You're killing grandma.
Get back in time, you can still pick the winning ticket and make somebody happy.
I'm going to marry you, Archie.
It's the Pepsi generation.
It has been said that film is more than a device to create a mood and tell a story. In Richard Lester's work, this becomes more than evident. Lester is one of a new group of directors who use film to jolt us out of our customary frame of life. Petulia, his new motion picture, is an uncommon movie. If you're like most and get with it pretty quickly, you will have a lot to talk about afterwards. He has chosen San Francisco as the background, a positive town where the images are forceful and an enormously attractive place for his people to shoot in. Come with Richard Lester as he takes you into the world of Petulia, a world filled with excitement, inspiration, and unexpected surprises. His zeal for the unique extends to his selection of performers and is no more apparent than in his choosing Academy Award winner Julie Christie and George C. Scott for the leading roles.
Action. Need any help?
Oh, here. No, have some. I love you.
I think it had to be made in America. I think the characters, the feeling I wanted to get into it was specifically American. Also, I think that these people would live in San Francisco.
All right, give me it back.
Come on, it's mine.
This you paid for.
Look, I brought...
Cut it out, stupid! You're gonna pay for
you
it!
You give me my sardines!
I don't have any set rules in dealing with actors or actresses. You have to get to know each person separately. You can't deal with Sir Laurence Olivier the way you would deal with Ringo. You try to find out a means of communication so that you can express yourself, perhaps clumsily, and perhaps only physically.
Archie.